Let's have our seat in the presence of the Lord. And I pray God will bless us in the mighty name of Jesus. And in the last time we met, we were talking about the economy of wisdom, which I gave the subtitle of it, the understanding of the spiritual pattern concerning the matter of faith and wisdom. Because there are the two things that looks alike, but there are the potential in two of them are totally different from each other. And at times you need to understand the protocol that guides a step of faith and the protocol that guides a step of wisdom. So, and you also have to have the understanding of the result you need to be expecting when you are taking the step of faith and the result you need to be expecting when you are taking the step of wisdom. And I said in the last teaching that faith has to do with matters of requesting God to come down and do something on your behalf, while wisdom has to do with asking God to give you ideas on how to do something. So, and I said this, that the mind of God pertaining to things of the earth is that we receive by faith into us, and we receive an idea from God on the step to take to carry out the faith that is within us. So there is connection between faith and work, and the work aspect of faith has to do with the wisdom aspect. But many of us think the work aspect of faith has to do with positive confession. Maybe somebody wake up in the morning and begin to say, I will make it today. Many people think that is the works of faith. You hear some people say you have to put your faith to works. And the mindset of the definition they portray in terms of putting your faith to works has to do with positive confession. As good as that may be, that is not the primary works that is attached to faith. The works that is attached to faith has to do with a wisdom step, that is a decision based on divine ideas. So you must know the different structure that govern faith and the different structure that govern wisdom. A man of wisdom, as I said in the last teaching, always pray for ideas. He doesn't pray for God to come down and do something miraculously. He pray for ideas on how to do something miraculously. So, and the protocols that guide wisdom have to do with principles, while the protocol that guide faith has to do with an instruction that go beyond the understanding of any man, of which the result is what we can define, but we can't define the process. But when it comes to wisdom, we can define the process. Now, get this. Every decision you are taking in life is governed under a theorem, and I want to discuss the theorem. Every decision, the moment that your decision cannot be found within the confines of this theorem, we classify that decision to be foolish in the sight of man, at the same time foolish decision in the sight of God. So when you are taking any step, you must pass it. When you are taking a decision, you must pass the theory step, which I want to discuss now. So if that your decision cannot pass the three tests I want to discuss, that decision can be described to be foolish in the sight of man, and can also be described to be foolish in the sight of God. There are certain decisions that are foolish in the sight of man, but they are not foolish in the sight of God. Where there are decisions that are foolish in the sight of God, but are not foolish in the sight of man. Where there are decisions that are foolish both in the sight of man and in the sight of God. So how do you know a decision that are foolish both in the sight of man and in the sight of God? That decision must be able to pass these three tests I want to discuss. And the first test is that your decision must pass the test of logic. Two, your decision must pass the test of divine wisdom. Three, your decision must pass the test of faith. So if it doesn't pass any one out of that three, it must be able to pass one out of that three. So if your decision could not pass the test of logic, it could not pass the test of faith, it could not pass the test of divine wisdom, that decision is classified to be foolish in the sight of man, at the same time foolish in the sight of God. Because the opposite of wisdom is foolishness. Just as the opposite of knowledge is ignorant, then the opposite of wisdom is foolishness. There is difference between taking a step of wisdom, taking a step of foolishness, a foolish decision, or taking a step in ignorance. There are two different things. You can be acting ignorantly, and you can also be acting foolishly. So there are difference between acting ignorantly and acting foolishly. So act ignorant is a state whereby you don't know what to do. So act foolishly is a situation whereby you don't know what to do, but you think you know what to do. So you are acting on a decision, thinking that decision is what you need to do, and at the end of the day, that decision is not what you need to do. Let me give an example. You don't have a job, and because you don't have a job, you stay at home. That is foolishness. That is ignorance. That is, you don't know what to do. Foolishness is that you don't have a job, you now start robbery. That is foolishness. So when you are taking a certain decision that is totally opposite to the protocols and the principles that is within the conference of a natural intelligence, within the conference of supernatural intelligence, when you are taking such decision to get a result that is natural or get a result that is supernatural, that action is called the action of foolishness. So if you are taking any decision, first thing we put it in the test of logic. And logic says, when you say you are doing something, men must be able to see the possibility of what you want to do, and you also must be able to see the possibility of what you want to do. That is logic. That if you say, I'm doing this thing, and men ask you, how can you achieve it? And you give accurate explanation on how you want to do it, and men can also have understanding of how you want to do that thing, that is logic. So it means that decision has passed the test of logic. That is, men can easily understand what you are trying to do. They know that 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. So they know that if you add 2 plus 2 together, the result will be 4. So men can predict the end point of that decision by your explanation and by their own by their own understanding and by their own experience. That's logic. Then divine wisdom. Divine wisdom is when you are taking a decision where you have understanding of what you are doing, but men do not have understanding of what you are doing. That is, you have come out of a zone of a popular opinion, you have come out of a zone of common philosophies to get a certain result, which simply means you have the understanding of what you want to do, you try to explain it to a man of natural understanding, but men of natural understanding cannot capture the reality of a step you want to take. So they cannot see how two can be added to two, and you will arrive at the equation and the answer you want to bring out of that decision. So at this stage, you are acting on an understanding that goes beyond the common understanding of a man. You have tapped into the frequency of eternity, and you have downloaded a certain decision from heaven. Of which that decision, you know the process and you know the result. But men could not know the process, so they can't predict the result. Then the third step is a step of faith. Step of faith, you are taking a step. By divine instruction, you yourself doesn't know how, you don't know the process. Men that are listening to you or that you explain to, they don't know how, they don't know the process, but God knows how and God knows the process. I think you can get the three. Step of logic, you say, I want to do this. Men can look at you and say, okay, when you do this is what you get. And you also have the understanding of what you will do and get the results. So both of you are natural men. You are in the same frequency. You are working pari passu. Your understanding can capture the reality of what you want to do. But the moment you come to a stage where you said, I want to do this thing, they ask you why. And you said, this is the way you want to do it. This is how you want to do it. This is the result you will get. They cannot fathom it. You are operating at higher decision, higher currency, higher level of wisdom that is totally different from the common way of thinking. But the moment your decision is faith, men cannot understand. You yourself doesn't understand what you are doing, but you are only acting according to instruction. That is, Holy Spirit speak to you. So if they ask you, why are you doing what you are doing? So just say, I am only obeying the instruction of God. So the result is usually miraculous, but the process is usually foolish. So the process is hidden to us. The process is hidden to you that is taking the decision. The process is hidden to the people that are watching you taking that decision. But God understands the process. God understands the decision. And God understand that. God knows how to bring that decision to reality. Because the process always contradicts. When it comes to divine wisdom, you can predict the process.
do this, and you get this result. But when it comes to step of faith, the process always contradicts the result. The process always looks foolish. The human understanding cannot comprehend the process, because 2 + 2, when it comes to faith, it can be 4. 2 + 2, when it comes to faith, can be 2,000. So it depends on the decision you are taking based on the instruction given to you by God. But one thing you need to be careful about: when you are taking a decision of faith, you must be sure it is God leading you. Because there is a difference between taking a step written in the Bible and hearing from God. There are differences between acting on the word of God and acting on the word from God. Acting on the word of God is not faith, it is presumption. Acting on the word from God, it is faith. So there are differences between taking a scripture and act upon it. You can injure yourself when you do that, because letter kill it. But when Holy Spirit speaks to you, it can use scripture to speak to you, fine. It can speak to you directly from the mind of God, fine. But you are sure that the Spirit is the one talking to you. And when Spirit is the one speaking to you concerning a certain decision, the result is usually tremendous. The result is usually supernatural. But where many make mistake is that many people have been attacked by religious spirit and they think Holy Spirit is the one speaking to them. And one thing about religious spirit is that it will destroy your life. It will make you to take a decision that you'll be frustrated. It will make you to take a decision you will think Holy Spirit has spoke to you. At the end of the day, men will mock you on that decision. You just wake up early in the morning, you say you are going to Lagos. So Holy Spirit asks you to go to Lagos to go and start a revival there. You don't know anybody. You get to Lagos, you are looking for a church to sleep. And the church didn't say they didn't know you are coming. And you started begging in the street to go back home. Not begging that you go, Holy Spirit send you here. That's an embarrassment to the integrity of God. Because when God send you there, it will surely make a way. So the moment you are not seeing way is a pure evidence that God didn't send you. Please come back home. So there are many people that are taking decisions in life that are totally contrary to the integrity of God. I was saying, given this, somebody told me, he said he wanted to start a school. Then I said to myself, I asked him, when I put the school in the test of logic, it didn't pass the test of logic. I put that school in the test of divine wisdom, it didn't pass the test of divine wisdom. I put that school in the test of faith, it didn't pass the test of faith. I told her, go and have patience. That is not what God is asking to do now. God may want you to have it, but understand the timing. Because one, it doesn't have money. And if you want to run a school, the first 5 years of that school, you won't get anything. You'll just be investing your money into it. So how will somebody who doesn't have any capital at grand want to start a school? You will run into frustration. That's one. Two, ask you, what are the process? Even though you don't have money, what are the process you want to put in place for this thing to be established? Because there are situations that can be established without money. But if you understand the principle, then it doesn't have any principle. It's just God will do it. Then thought, as did God spoke to you that you should start it? He said no, he just want to act in faith. But that is not faith, that is presumption. And those are the decisions that men took that lead them to destruction. So you must know the decision you are taking, whether this one will pass the test, is passing the test of logic, is passing the test of divine wisdom, or passing the test of faith. So it must be able to pass one out of those three tests. So if you don't have the ability to tap into divine wisdom, you don't have the ability to hear from God, please stay in logic. Common sense is not common. Because I do say it, we have three kinds of sense. We have common sense, uncommon sense, and out of sense. So if your decision is not common sense, let it be uncommon sense. And if it is not common sense, don't take out of sense. Don't take decision that is out of sense. Don't take decision, I repeat, don't take decision that is out of sense. If you don't have the ability to tap into divine wisdom, stay in logic. That is, ensure you are within the confines of natural understanding so that you will be saved. Because that is so that you will be saved. When it comes to you will be in safety. Let me use that language. Because when the scripture says we should not rely on our own understanding, yes, scripture is saying that on a matter whereby God wants you to rely on him. But in a situation whereby you have relied on God, or in a situation whereby God is not speaking to you, God is not asking you to take any decision, stay within the confines of logic. The common sense that God gives to us is a gift. I repeat, the common sense that God gave to us is a gift. But it is unfortunate today that many are taking a decision called faith, and at the end of the day, when you can read the handwriting of that decision, you will see that this is a pure foolishness. It is a foolish decision in the sight of man, at the same time, it's a foolish decision in the sight of God. It is just a religious decision. And the most foolish decision you can take in life is when you take a religious decision. that is take the decision because Holy Spirit is speaking to you, thinking it is the Holy Spirit, but that spirit is religious spirit. So you must understand this theory. So stay within the conference of logic if you don't understand how to tap into divine wisdom. And the best way to tap into divine wisdom, I said there are two ways of tapping into divine wisdom. It's either you receive, you encounter the spirit of wisdom, or you discover a wisdom in a book. So wisdom is always hidden in the book. It's either you encounter the spirit of wisdom, or you discover a wisdom in a book. So for those that doesn't have the ability, for those that doesn't have the grace to encounter the spirit of wisdom, the book of wisdom is given to you. Men who encounter the spirit has written different kind of books. So if you want to be loaded with the wisdom of God on this earth, pay attention to books. Wisdom is always hidden in the books. And I do recommend that if you want to enjoy books, get the books of a teacher. That is this person a teacher? That's my personal principles. I don't just read books. The first question is this person a teacher? Miles Moria cannot write book on leadership. I want prophet to write book on leadership and expect me to read the book of a prophet on leadership. Because he is not a teacher. Even though he's leading his ministry successfully, but he can't write a book based on his own experience. Because the pattern through which he is leading his ministry is not a yardstick that everybody can follow. That's why the roles of a teacher is needed in the body of Christ. Because teachers are the one that can teach you from the conference of balanced theology. Most of people that teach usually teach from personal experience. And when you are teaching from personal experience, you will put many people into bondage. You will put them into calamity. Because personal experience is not a yardstick for general template to build their life. Can I say this? That you are working in power doesn't mean you can write a book on power. Because many things you will write there, they are going to be personal experience. I prefer to read a teacher who wrote book on power, who is not working in power, than reading a prophet who wrote book on power that is working in power. Because a coach are not usually the best player. A coach. So that somebody is the best player, that doesn't mean he can be a best coach. And that's the grace of Paul Tisha. They can coach you to a reality to become what you are destined to become. Many people do usually teach people to become what they become. But a teacher will teach you to become what you are destined to become, not what he became. So coach doesn't teach people to become coach. He teaches them to become the best player. A coach may not even know how to play corner kick, but he can teach you and be the best. Is it corner kicker? In the old Nigeria or in the old country. I'm not a football fan, so mind my word. Don't mind my speech. I mean to say, are you getting what I'm saying now? So a coach are not usually the best player, but they are best coach. So you don't choose coach because he's the best player. And that's one of the mistakes we do in religious circles. So somebody is working in power, you think he's the best person that can teach your power. No. Secular men have this understanding. They look for skillful people who can educate, not skillful people who have the practical experience. Teacher doesn't usually have practical experience, but they know how to make you to have practical experience. That's the reality. So I prefer to read books on leadership, read books on power written by a teacher than a books on power written by a prophet. Because there is this articulate way of explaining things, articulate way of expressing things that is upon the life of a teacher. And I pray God will bless us in the mighty name of Jesus.
Thanks. Thank you.